This is WBSM On Demand. Players.
It's time for South Coast Now with Chris McCarthy. Streaming live on WBSM.com and the WBSM app. Call 508-996-0500. Text us using app chat on the WBSM app. Now, Chris McCarthy.
Good morning. Good morning. Welcome to the third and final hour for the day of the program. I'm Chris McCarthy. Normally, this is the time we have the mayor in here, but the mayor was here just an hour ago, so you missed him. Just a few minutes ago, he walked out the door, and in came Rosemary Gill, the delightful executive director?
President and CEO.
President and CEO of the Zeiterion Theater here in New Bedford. And it's really a marvelous facility, and you folks have done marvelous programming for years now. Let's talk about the project, the revitalization. What's happening down there at the Zeiterion Theater?
Yeah, thank you, Chris, for having me on. It's been a while, and so I'm thrilled to be here, especially at this juncture for our organization and for the community. We are about to break ground on an incredible renovation and restoration of the Zeiterion Theater and the four floors that are kind of considered front of house.
Okay.
And so we've been working on this for quite a while, many, many years, and to see it come to fruition is pretty exciting.
It has been many years. Mm-hmm. And over the years, you folks have had a lot of really great acts come through.
Mm-hmm.
It is, and I talk to business people downtown, it's an economic driver for mm-hmm. the downtown.
Mm-hmm.
Talk a little bit about the fact, what the Zeiterion brings in for acts and people and crowds from all over the region. Talk a little bit with that, Rosemary.
Sure. Well, the Zeiterion is a presenting organization, so we bring in touring acts from all over the world, as well as regionally and statewide and nationally. And as a consequence, we have a pretty significant economic impact on the area. Any given show, and each and every show, we are hiring local crew to load in and load out all of the shows. I think people don't always understand that. They assume that the shows come with their own crew, which they do. They have their crew as well. But if we bring in like a Broadway show, for example, we're hiring anywhere from 60 to 80 people just to load in and load out and support the show.
I hadn't realized that.
Yeah. And then we're also hiring, and they're our employees. We're hiring bartenders and security staff and front of house and very specifically trained production personnel like lighting engineers, sound engineers, carpenters, wardrobe folks, hairdressers. All of that is local folks who are
yeah. I didn't realize yeah. that. I think I was under the impression they just came. They were like they came with it.
No. Those are all our personnel. And we love it, and it's just an amazing opportunity. But even before a show comes, we're utilizing and hiring local people like printers and, graphic design and caterers and all kinds of local folks. And then when the show comes, and even, the weekend of any given show, folks are coming in to have dinner. Everyone knows downtown that, to brace yourself for a Z night, that the restaurants are going to be crowded and you should plan accordingly. And And very, very often our shows bring in tourists, sometimes more than 30% of the audience, for example, is coming in from greater than 50 miles.
Really?
We have the statistics to support that. We track each and every show. We track zip codes where ticket buyers are coming from, and we know, which shows are have a broader reach. And those people we know are going to be staying at hotels, and
sure,
they're going to be shopping and doing all those things that help the local economy.
Yeah, I have a friend of mine who's got, knows quite a bit about the restaurant business. He owns a couple of them down in that area. And he says, look, without a doubt, the Z is an important part of the downtown mix.
Mm-hmm.
An economic driver.
Yeah, and unfortunately, that's become crystal clear while we're closed,
yes,
awaiting renovation, and even clearer with the unfortunate closure of CVPA, the Star Store building. So I think folks downtown are really feeling the absence of both organizations. So we're doing our darndest to make sure that we come online as soon as possible, because we know what it means for local businesses.
We have Rosemary Gill. She's the executive director and the CEO of the Zeiterion Theater in the city of New Bedford. If you have a question, you can at 508-996-0500. How do you decide what acts to book? How do you decide, for instance, I know it was a number of years ago now, but the group Asia was there. I remember that. James Brown, of course, came through there. There's a lot of big acts that come through, and there's lesser acts, you know. How does that get decided? Do you decide? Is it a committee? Explain to me.
So currently I am the curator of the season for the most part. I have folks who help me and who provide insight and ideas and suggestions. And what we're looking for is just kind of a rich mix of artists that will appeal to our community. And we try to ensure that we are representing our community throughout the season, and we have something for everyone. Now, do we always have something for everyone? Not always. But I actually really believe that almost every show, if you show up, you're going to, whether you knew the artist or beforehand or didn't know the artist, you're going to walk away saying, wow.
Sure. Sure.
The Zeiterion brought it and this artist brought it and I enjoyed myself. And, it might not have been necessarily my cup of tea, but I know I saw the highest quality, and that's what we strive for, to bring in those artists who are working very hard to create a performance that is at the top of their game and the highest quality that we can afford to bring.
508-996-0500. Folks, one of my best sponsors, Mac Auto Sales, 188 Rivet Street in New Bedford. They repair all makes and models. So if you need to get your car ready for the summer, it's a lot cheaper, by the way, to get your car ready than opposed to get it fixed afterwards, right? Update the car, have it tuned up, whatever. Call Mac Auto Sales and Repair, 508-565-6221. They're open weekdays 9 to 5. If you have a foreign car that needs repair, Mac Auto Sales specializes in foreign car servicing. Ask about their aftermarket accessories and quality used cars that are for sale. Stick around. We're going to take a quick break. We'll be right back. With us, and I'm learning a lot about the Zeiterion. So you seat 1,200 people.
Mm-hmm.
And we were talking about how you bring in acts, things like that.
Mm-hmm.
Talk a little bit more about that, how you do that. And primarily, you're the curator, so you do most of it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and we're looking to expand that, actually, to bring in more voices to how we curate our season. We'll definitely be doing that before we reopen. But what happens is we establish very strong relationships with artist management and artist agencies. So the biggies like the William Morris and the CAAs and the UTAs of the world. I meet with those agents on a regular basis. I travel to regional and national conferences and sometimes international conferences to check out artists and to see what they're doing. And, and with the you know, with these relationships that we built with the agents, I know what their roster of agents is. So sometimes I reach out to them and say, you know, hey, what's going on with that artist? When are they going back on tour? And, you know, I'd love to get them on the next tour. And other times they're telling me who's on tour, and they're trying to put together a tour. And so that's how that happens. We make a lot of offers over the years, you know, over any particular, you know, for any particular season, for example. Okay. If we bring in 60 shows, I've probably made twice that in offers. Sure. That don't get accepted, sure. Right? So half of them don't get accepted for various reasons. Either we're getting outbid by competitors, and this is a really kind of a thick marketplace. New England has a lot of venues. Other times it's just, you know, the dates don't work, or they don't have enough dates. There's all kinds of factors that come into place. Sometimes it's, you know, what we call tech specs don't quite meet the criteria of a particular show.
Okay.
But half the time it does work, and sure, we're bringing, you know, great artists to New Bedford.
We have Rosemary Gill from the Zeiterion Theater. How important is the financial support of the municipal government here, the city of New Bedford? How important is that to the Zeiterion?
Yeah, that's critically important for us. So I need to go back a little bit. So when I took over in 2013, we did not have any type of formal agreement with the city, no lease, anything like that. And we've been around for 40 years. Building just celebrated 100 last year, and we celebrated our 40th last year as well. And we, it was costing the private nonprofit. We were able to demonstrate close to $500,000 annually to run and operate and maintain the building.
Okay.
So we started having conversations with the city. The city, it's a city-owned building, and the city put out a request for proposals for entities to respond to who wanted to do just that, manage and operate the building. We responded and we won the bid.
Okay.
And as a consequence, we are responsible on an annual basis to run the building, provide professional staff, a box office that's open every day year-round, right? Most days year-round, custodial crew, front of house crew, all of those things that are required to operate a performing arts center. And we do this not only for the shows that we present, but for resident companies, New Bedford Symphony Orchestra and New Bedford Festival Theater, and other users of the building. There's lots of folks who rent the building. We host a lot of community events. And we do that either at a very reduced rate or free of charge. And that's all part of the support that we get from the city. It doesn't come close to what we expend.
Sure.
The Z is a nonprofit. We subsidize that through our fundraising and through private donors and foundations and sponsors, you know, corporate sponsors, et cetera.
But when you responded to the RFP, it was with the anticipation the city would be contributing financially.
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I just want people at home to understand that.
Yeah, and that's
yeah.
done all over the country.
Yes.
All over the country, probably all over the world, where municipal buildings like the Zeiterion that are specifically, by the way, that building has a historic lien on it. The only thing it can be is a theater.
Interesting.
It can't be, it's not as if
we can't make it into housing.
No, right. No, it has to be a theater. And so the city understands that, and they want it. And when they understand what it means for a city to have a thriving performing arts center. We provide educational opportunities for people of all ages, but primarily for students from pre-K to 12. More than, nearly, I think, 20,000 students come through our doors on an annual basis from New Bedford and the surrounding communities from about a 40-mile radius.
One of the things I think that you do that's fantastic down there is bring Broadway shows to New Bedford.
Mm-hmm.
Because I grew up out in Freetown, and my parents were a little older, and they made sure we went to things like that. We went to New York City, went to Boston, things like that. But not everybody has parents like that, or you know, and who are able to do that.
That's right.
And so that is a marvelous contribution that you make to New Bedford. Mm-hmm. That if you weren't here, it wouldn't happen. And that is a culture is a major part of anyone's enrichment. I think personally,
yeah,
that I'm
course.
A better person today because my parents brought me to things like that, and because they were able to do it. And so the fact that you bring it here and make it easier for parents to do it is important.
Well, tell me more about, you know, your statement, you're a better person. In what way do you consider yourself a better person?
I can make wise jokes on the radio, basically.
Well, you have a sense of humor.
I do have a marvelous sense of humor. Mm-hmm. No, but really, I think that there's nothing like when the lights go up and the light, you know, for a play, right? I knew to go see it when I became an adult, right? Because I had been brought up with it. So when I took my girlfriend to the Wang Theater to see Phantom of the Opera, for instance, it was not an odd experience for me because my parents had brought me to that stuff. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
So I do think that cultural enrichment is very important.
It is. It makes us all better citizens.
Yes.
It makes us, you know, it fosters creativity.
Well, speak for yourself
on that. It fosters empathy.
I don't know if I'm a better citizen for it, but my point being is it is culture, theater, thing are very important.
Mm-hmm.
They really are important.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And there are a lot of people in this community, as you point out, that make a living from this.
There sure are.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
And it shouldn't just have to be the theater over in Carver. Right, that once in a while thing. What is it? The King Richard's Fair. I remember interviewing someone when I was a reporter who said they were an actor, and I said, "Where?" And they said, "Well, King Richard's Fair." I said, "What do you do with the rest of the year?" You know, type of thing. So you do offer a lot of opportunities for people.
Yeah, we have over a $10 million economic impact on the region, and we support 338 jobs, and that's not something that we just say. We had an independent entity, you know, do that math for us, do that work for us, and create, you know, an economic impact report that lays that out. So, and we see it every day. I see it every day. You know, we have over 100 people on our payroll, about 20-something on a regular basis, you know, on a daily basis. It takes a lot. And that's just us. That's not counting the symphony and festival theater. And the other uses of the building. So it's important. It's a busy building. You know, there's something going on there all the time. And with the renovation, we're creating new spaces and new opportunities for people to be in the building other than just, you know, kind of the Friday night lights, fancy clothes, fancy people kind of activity. We're going to have spaces where people from all over the community will be able to participate in the performing arts and utilize spaces that the city has never had before.
You've had a lot of famous names over the years. You were talking earlier about how you booked those. What sort of acts are you looking to bring in the future in the new revitalized theater?
I would say, you know, of course, some of the same, but we're really looking to expand and to bring in artists that represent not only our community, so that people in our community can see themselves on the stage, but, a real diversity of performing arts that are out there and that maybe we haven't been able to bring thus far. And I think that's going to come with new ways of programming, bringing in more than just myself and some of the others on my staff to help decide who's on the stage. I think that's critically important, and we'll be doing just that.
So talk about some of these improvements you're making to the Zeiterion Theater.
Yeah, so exciting, Chris. So we, since 2018, we have been actively involved in a capital project to renovate and restore the building. We're going to be completely restoring the theater. It's a 100-year-old building, as I mentioned before. And so inside of the theater, what people, it'll have a similar look and feel because it is historic. So we have to maintain kind of that look and feel, but brand new seats, new accommodations to create easier accessibility. So we'll have a ramp that'll go down the entire length of the theater. We'll be what we call re-raking the theater, which is essentially regrading the theater to improve the grade and make it easier for people to go up and down. And so, you know, kind of the front of the house to the back of the house. We'll have a brand new orchestra pit with a hydraulic lift.
Nice.
Bathrooms will have with more than doubling the bathrooms. The men's room, for example, right now is down, you know, a treacherous set of stairs. We'll be bringing that up to the main floor. The women's room will be doubling. And anybody who's ever come to the theater, you know, both the seats and the bathroom are, you know, some of our number one complaints.
Okay.
Although everybody loves to come, the joke is, you know, I sat with a spring on my bum for half of the show.
Absolutely. No,
and I waited in the long line to get into the restroom. So we'll be improving that. We'll be expanding the lobby. We'll be creating a really some fun new spaces, a speakeasy in the basement, which will be a brand new event space. For the first time, we'll have dedicated education space. So we'll have a movement studio and classrooms. So that we can really broaden and deepen the educational programming that we offer to the community. So it's super, super exciting. New box office. You know, it's really going to look and feel different. A marquee is going to be returning to the exterior of the building.
That's important.
Yeah.
Right. That's an important look for the downtown. 508-996-0500. Folks, I want to point you in the direction south of... citywideglass.net, citywideglass.net. If you have a crack in your windshield or side mirrors, your sunroof, right? You ever have a crack in your sunroof? I have. And the next thing you know, you have a puddle full of water in your front seat. You got to reach out to Citywide Glass. Citywide Glass, you can give them a call. They're in Dartmouth and they're in Fall River. Citywideglass.net. They will come right out to your house for no additional cost. They'll come to your work. If, for instance, if my Volvo had a crack in the windshield, they could come right here to the parking lot and fix it, no additional cost, and come right to my house and fix it as well. All you have to do is tell them that you need help. They'll come out to you. No additional cost. Citywide Glass, they take all insurance. That means no money out of your pocket. We have the CEO, Rosemary Gill of the Zeiterion Theater here in studio, taking your calls as well. I'm looking forward to this new theater, the historic theater, but it will be have a new look, including new seats and a new way to get a drink. So what could be wrong with that, right? We have some people on hold. Good morning. Thanks for holding.
Good morning.
What's happening?
So, good morning. I actually had a quick question. Does the Zeiterion do any partnerships with, like, the local school programs, local music programs, or theater drama clubs and stuff like that?
We do, and we'd love to do more, but in the past, we've done some great partnerships with New Bedford Music Department, the band, the theater groups, and then Dartmouth High School and Dartmouth Public Schools as well. I know Mattapoisett. So, yeah, we do a lot of work. We have a really robust educational program, and we have a great education and community outreach team that engages with the local school districts, and actually school districts from about a 40-mile radius.
That's actually really great. I think that's critically important as you have a new generation coming up and growing up in the area to be exposed to the arts and to performing arts in general.
Yes,
I have a music background myself, so that's why I was interested in hearing what you guys are doing in regards to partnerships with different public schools. Thank you.
Yeah, we love partnering them, and we bring in annually almost 20,000 school kids from New Bedford and the community to enjoy performances, many of which are offered on the main stage, and we charge you know, we subsidize each and every one of those tickets, so they're very inexpensive for
I noticed the city had that in the agreement that you will provide below cost for students, things like that. That's right in the agreement, which the city council is discussing. Were you surprised the city council tabled it or put it on hold?
Well, as the meeting progressed, I wasn't surprised.
Okay. Do you feel comfortable that whatever questions they had, have they reached out to you as individuals to try to get some of these questions answered? Because I think that's my understanding was, as I was watching the meeting, same as you, I thought, I think that there's a lack of understanding here. And you get it. It's a lot of information. Do you feel like they've got the answers they needed?
I think so. They're, you know, and I talk to many of the counselors on a regular basis, and I would say the majority of them kind of understand. And there was some conversation that went a little too heavy on some minor details that certainly can, you know, we're in conversation about so that we can bring it back up.
Yeah. Having been in government, I know sometimes you see things and you don't quite understand it, but now you're in a meeting. So start asking more questions and it gets a little off topic maybe. We got some people on hold. Good morning. Thanks for holding. You're live on the air.
Yes, good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
It makes it sound like your funding totally comes from the city. Do you have access to resources from the state and the federal government too to help you in your productions?
Yeah, I think it's the opposite of that, really. Go ahead.
Yeah, so our budget, you know, pre-COVID, and you know, we were closed for 19 months during the pandemic. We were the first to close and the last to reopen. Mm-hmm. But our budget pre-COVID was about $3.5 million. The city contribution thus far is $210,000. So it represents, you know, a fairly small portion of our budget. We most of our budget comes from earned income, so that's ticket revenue and concessions and things like that. But we also do a significant amount of fundraising to support what we do and what we offer
my
the
question
community.
But my question was, do you get any money from the state? Like, I think it's Mass Council on the Arts and or anything from the federal government in the form of a grant.
We do. We receive funding from the Mass Cultural Council. We often receive money from the Mass Office of Travel and Tourism. And we get typically a earmark every year.
Senator Montigny delivers.
Senator Montigny, Representative Cabral, the entire delegation really is very, very supportive of the Zeiterion.
And again, you annually anticipate you bring thousands of people to the downtown who would otherwise not be there.
That's right.
Right?
Mm-hmm.
From all over the region and from out of state.
Yeah, I think we were off air, Chris, and we were chatting about, you know, we track our ticket buyers based on the zip code. You know, we don't know a lot about our ticket buyers, but we do know typically, you know, where they're coming from. And, you know, depending on the show, sometimes it's just hyper local, like within a 10-mile radius. But several shows, we see up to, you know, 35-40% coming from greater than 50 miles, which we know means that they'll likely be staying at a hotel and likely eating in a restaurant. I would say even those folks that are within 10 miles are likely eating at a restaurant before coming to the show. But those who might stay over, you know, we know we're a tourism driver.
508-996-0500. We have Rosemary Gill. She's CEO of the Zeiterion Theater, explaining to us what they do down there and how great it's going to be. It's going to be even better than what it's been when they reopen. We're going to take a quick break, folks. Stick around. We'll be right back. Antipasto salads and much more. They have family size and party size platters conveniently packaged and ready to serve. They're the perfect addition to your graduation party. Riccardi's Restaurant is the one stop you have to make to ensure your party is a success. Visit Riccardi's.com for more information to order online. Riccardi's is a good place to go after you leave the Zeiterion.
Oh my gosh, I'm hungry. That sounds really yummy.
It is, right? So how did we get to this moment in time, right, where you're making all these renovations?
Sure. We actually haven't started the renovations yet, but we've been, you know, actively planning and fundraising to get to this point since 2018, I think I mentioned, and survived the pandemic, which is unbelievable.
Sure.
And we, you know, are at a point where we've secured over, you know, or will be securing over $34 million for this project. It's just a gigantic and restoration. It's a major amount of money. Just blows me away every time I think about it. And we've secured this money from lots of different sources, federal and state historic tax credits. I mentioned it is a historic building, which means we qualify for the historic tax credit program, which is incredibly complex and took us 3 years to get through. But we're on the other side of that, I'm pleased to say. And then ARPA funds have been incredibly helpful for the project, as well as, you know, private philanthropy. And, you know, and the ARPA funds come, backing up a little bit, come from both the state and the city. Mm-hmm. And then private philanthropy from individuals, as well as corporate sponsors and foundations. So it's an impressive stack of funds.
Yes,
and
it
sources.
Really is.
Yeah.
And you'll be hiring local contractors to do a lot of that work, I would assume.
We hired a contractor. We just recently hired a contractor. We have to follow public procurement, so we don't get to choose actually who our contractor
is. Three bids and all that stuff.
They have to. We had four bids.
Four bids.
And we have to select the lowest responsible bidder. And I'm very, very pleased to let you know that we've selected Colantonio Inc. out of Holliston, Mass.
Okay.
And they have a great reputation. We're thrilled to be working with them very soon. They'll be breaking ground in the next several weeks.
Oh, that's wild.
Yeah, it feels really good. It's been a long time coming.
I can imagine.
And it's really been an incredible project that's involved so many people, and the support of some, you know, hundreds and hundreds of people to get here. And you know, the goal is to create a building and an organization that will have a lasting impact on our community, and we'll be here for another 100 years, and future right. generations will be able to enjoy.
We have Rosemary Gill from the Zeiterion Theater. She's the CEO of the Zeiterion Theater downtown. If you'd like to ask a Zeiterion-related question, you can at 508-996-0500. Good morning. Thanks for holding. You're on the air. Hello?
Good morning.
Hey, what's happening?
Good morning.
I can hear you, yes.
I can hear me. Okay, thank you. How hard would it be to bring like a big art performer like a Chris Hart or a Sebastian into the area? Is it because our venue is small than, say, the Wayne Fair in Boston? Or what kind of things that we can entice them to come here? Is it because of the hotel accommodations or anything like that? Would deter somebody to come into this area?
Thanks for the question.
Style like that?
Thank you.
I actually didn't catch the second.
Yeah. What was the second artist you were looking for?
Was it Botticelli? Something like that.
I think.
Andrea Botticelli.
That may have been what he said.
Well, I actually think we do bring in
I
really
was
big
say,
acts.
Jay Leno.
We've had Jay Leno, right. Yo-Yo Ma, James Brown, Joan right. Rivers, David Byrne, David Crosby. I mean, we've had some pretty impressive and incredible artists come through our doors
yes.
and stay at our hotels and you know, visit restaurants and... So, but, you know, there's a lot that comes into play in bringing artists. We do only have 1,200 seats, so the economics have to work, right? The
sure
larger the
that.
Artist, the larger the artist fee. You know, we contract with these artists, and mm-hmm. they have, you know, a pretty set fee that they ask. So, you know, I mean, you know, someone like Bruce Springsteen or the Rolling Stones or...
Sure. It would have to be like $10,000 a seat because
because
the size of the venue.
They're
right.
getting millions of dollars for right. any given night.
Have you ever seen a rider that says no brown M&Ms?
We see some really fun riders.
Do you?
And yeah.
Did you ever see Greg Allman's rider?
I have not seen Greg Allman's rider.
He's dead now anyways.
Yeah. But we've seen some from... They're always a hoot.
Yeah.
And they're...
So the people don't know, that is what the artist needs for the performance. So food, things like that, right?
Yeah, it's where they lay out. It's how we understand what they'll need for the show, both on a production side of things, so things like lighting and sound and staging. But then also their hospitality.
Sure.
We provide hospitality, and we have to hire caterers for every show, for not only the artists and the crew that comes with the artists, but also our local crew, because they don't have an opportunity to leave the building.
If someone, for instance, was a caterer or they did lighting, things like that, how would one get on the list to be possibly selected to provide service?
We're always looking and we're always interested. And they can just visit our website. The posting is always active on our website, Zeiterion.org.
Perfect. So when you have to... It's really about the economics, right?
It is the economics, yeah, for the most part. Sometimes some artists don't want to perform in a performing arts center with kind of fixed seating. They want maybe to perform in a space that has standing room only, or more danceable. So that kind of dictates the type of artist as well.
Sure.
But it's primarily economics.
508-996-0500. Zeiterion Theater, as you said, it does require a minor taxpayers may not think this, but really the percentage of the money that makes up your whole budget is not the city contribution.
No. We're extremely grateful for it.
Of course.
And we need every penny.
Of course.
But it doesn't represent a significant part of our, I'll take away the significant, edit that out. It doesn't represent a huge part of our budget, but it is critically important.
It's critically important, but then you're able to use that money, and with the private donations makes the whole thing work.
Right.
And which ultimately has a major economic and cultural impact on the city of New Bedford.
Yeah.
Which sets the city of New Bedford, say, apart from other cities its size that don't have these theaters, which, as the mayor says to me, we're lucky to have Rosemary Gill and the folks of the Zeiterion Theater working in that city building, because other cities don't have that.
Yeah, it's true. And New Bedford, I don't know if people know this, but we had, downtown had something like 17 theaters. Yeah. We're the last one.
It's amazing.
That is, doing what a theater does, right? And so we feel a keen sense of responsibility to keep that up and ensure that we maintain and offer this for, as we mentioned, for future generations. It's really preserving the past and creating opportunities and memories and enrichment for the future.
When do you anticipate you'll be open again?
This question I love. Ideally, by the last quarter of 2025, but everything has to go right for that to happen. So I don't, who knows?
I get that.
We're opening walls of a 100-year-old building, and we're literally excavating the entire, because we're regrading the theater, we're excavating the entire interior of the theater. So, we think we've done a lot of work to determine what's behind the walls and what's under the ground and
I
all
hadn't
of that.
Thought about it that
but,
way.
Who knows what we'll actually.
Yeah, you're opening find. Up a 100-year-old building.
Mm-hmm.
That's really interesting. I was excited to book Disappointment because mm-hmm. I recognized I didn't know that much about it other mm-hmm. than, the few times I'd been there.
Mm-hmm.
And I hadn't thought about it that way, right?
Mm-hmm.
What are you going to find? Right?
Hopefully nothing terribly exciting.
Well, I guess that's true.
Right?
You hope not, right?
Yeah.
But Rosemary Gill is here. I do appreciate you coming in. I really do.
No, I'm glad.
I think this has been really educational. It's been educational for me, but also for the audience as mm-hmm. well. And hopefully people recognize the significant impact that you have in the region.
Yeah, I hope so. I hope they understand what we contribute to the community, what we're looking to contribute to the community. We're hoping to, you know, really expand upon the current partnerships that we have with businesses and educational institutions and just individuals in New Bedford and the greater New Bedford area. We're excited to what is to come.
508-996-05. Folks, we're going to take a quick break, and then we'll be right back. Rosemary Gill here, just finishing up the program. I've learned a lot. I've enjoyed this. Sure, you were talking about the financial impacts. That's what a lot of this is about. Mm-hmm. You're going to be relieving the city of an obligation?
Yes. So we're about to execute a 99-year lease with the city. We'll be doing that in conjunction with kind of closing on all of the bank finances that we'll need to close on in order to begin the project. And what that does is it's a ground lease, so it relieves the city from all of the expenses that it's incurred on an annual basis to maintain and keep up, the city-owned building. Mm-hmm. So the Zeiterion will be absorbing those expenses, which is one of the reasons why we're asking for an increase from the regular management contract that we've had thus far. It's because we'll be assuming all of that and then some.
Yes.
And also, the improvements to the building won't require as much maintenance, we hope, for a long, long time. And and as I mentioned, this, the Z as a private nonprofit has expended its own resources, mm-hmm, to the tune of hundreds of thousands of dollars to plan and fundraise and execute this capital project for a city-owned asset. And we think it's all worth it. We think it's a deal for the city, and we're proud to be in the place that we are right now.
Rosemary, I don't think we've done this yet. What is the website for the Zeiterion Theater?
Zeiterion.org.
Zeiterion.org. So if you want more information about that, if you are a caterer or something along those lines, if you're looking for work, if you're in the arts, if you're interested in it, or if you're a teacher planning field trips, things like that, reach out through Zeiterion.org.
Yeah, and you can also see more information about the capital project. There's some great artist renderings and lots of information.
There's a lot of good stuff over there, folks, so mm-hmm, check it out. Look, folks, it's the end of the hour for me. I'm going to go out and enjoy the sunshine. And Barry Richard will be up next. Of course, we have Bill O'Reilly. He'll be here. And then, not here, but he'll be piped in. And then Barry Richard will be here as well to take your phone calls. Remember, Barry broke the big story yesterday. I'm sure he's going to talk more about it, about this homeless tent city that Mass and Cass is what I'm calling it. What Shane Burgo, in his infinite wisdom, wants to build for the city of New Bedford down at the airport, smack dab in the middle of Ward 1 and Ward 3. A Mass and Cash-like encampment that the mayor already threw cold water on today for me and for you. The mayor said it's not going to happen, but let's let Shane Burgo's pipe dreams go on. But you, Barry Richard, will entertain your phone calls in the next hour at 508-996-05. And I want you to have a wonderful Memorial Day weekend. I will not be here on Monday. But I will be here on Thursday. So stick around. I'll be back, and God willing, tomorrow. Have a great day.